The Great Moon Hoax of 1835. You heard correctly, 1835, not 1969. Part 1. Introduction. We tend to think that sensational or scandalous stories are a modern tactic used by newspapers and magazines to increase circulation. But it is a tactic that has always been used ever since newspapers were introduced in the 17th century. Keep listening, because this little-known event of 1835 remains to this day one of the most sensational hoaxes of all time. That's right, of all time. Part 2. New Discoveries. The Great Moon Hoax was a series of articles published in The Sun, a New York newspaper, considered a serious paper, like the city's two more successful broadsheets, The New York Times and The New York Herald Tribune. The articles were about the supposed discovery of life and even civilization on the moon. The discoveries were falsely attributed to the English Sir John Herschel, one of the best-known astronomers of that time. The story was advertised on August 21, 1835, as an upcoming feature allegedly reprinted from the Scottish newspaper The Edinburgh Current. It teasingly stated that Sir John Herschel had made some new discoveries. The first in a series of six articles was published 4 days later on August 25. The first sensational headline read, "Great Astronomical Discoveries Lately Made by Sir John Herschel, at the Cape of Good Hope." The articles described animals on the moon, including bison, goats, unicorns, bipedal-tailless beavers, and bat-like, yellow-faced winged humanoids, who built a sapphire temple. There were volcanoes, mountains, trees, oceans, beaches, and red flowers. The author of the articles was the fictitious Dr. Andrew Grant, the supposed traveling companion and secretary of Sir John Herschel. All these wonders were supposedly seen with an immense telescope of an entirely new principle. Eventually, the authors announced that the observations had been terminated by the destruction of the telescope, through the sun causing the lens to act as a burning glass, setting fire to the observatory and destroying it. It was not discovered to be a hoax for several weeks after its publication, and even then the newspaper did not issue a retraction. Part 3. Who was responsible? Authorship of the article has been attributed to Richard Adams Locke, 1800-1871, a reporter working for The Sun in August 1835. And Locke himself publicly admitted to being the author in 1840, in a letter to the weekly paper New World. However, rumors persisted that others were involved. Jean-Nicolas Nicolet, a French astronomer traveling in America at the time, and Louis Gaylord Clark, editor of the Knickerbocker, a literary magazine that later in 1847, would publish for the first time the now famous, "Why Did the Chicken Cross the Road?" joke. There is no good evidence to indicate that anyone but Locke was the author of the hoax, and his intentions were probably first to create a sensational story which would increase sales of the Sun newspaper, and second, to ridicule some of the more extravagant astronomical theories that had recently been published. For instance, in 1824, Franz von Paul Grüthausen, professor of astronomy at Munich University, had published a paper titled "Discovery of Many Distinct Traces of Lunar Inhabitants, Especially of One of Their Colossal Buildings." Grüthausen claimed to have observed various shades of color on the lunar surface, which he correlated with climate and vegetation zones. He also observed lines and geometrical shapes, which he felt indicated the existence of walls, roads, fortifications, and cities. A more direct object of Locke's satire was the British Reverend Thomas Dick, a church minister, science teacher and writer, known for his works on astronomy and practical philosophy, combining science and Christianity, and arguing for a harmony between the two. He was known as the Christian philosopher after the title of his first book published in 1823, The Christian Philosopher, or The Connection of Science and Philosophy with Religion. In later works, he claimed that the solar system contained almost 22 trillion inhabitants, and the moon alone, by his count, would contain over 4 billion. This was calculated by using the surface area of each planet and the population density of England. His writings were enormously popular in the United States and he became a target for ridicule and satire. Part 4. Reactions. The story spread like wildfire in America and Europe, with other notable newspapers and magazines giving extensive coverage. Meanwhile, The Sun was making money, immediately selling the series in a pamphlet along with various lithographic prints showing artists' depictions of scenes, commissioned from Wall Street lithographers Norris and Baker. It has been said that 60,000 of the pamphlets sold, but only 16 exist today as collector's items. While there were plenty of skeptics in the media, looking into accounts of people who lived at the time, it is apparent that the majority of the public accepted the reality of life on the moon, initially. That quickly changed, however, as more and more credible newspapers took the articles to task. Regardless of being called out as a hoax, The Sun wasn't fazed, with many praising it as a clever joke. In fact, The Sun would continue its successful publishing until 1950. According to legend, The Sun's circulation increased dramatically because of the hoax and remained permanently greater than before, thereby establishing The Sun as a successful paper. However, the degree to which the hoax increased the paper's circulation has certainly been exaggerated in popular accounts of the event. Sir John Herschel was initially amused by the hoax, noting that his own real observations could never be as exciting. But, he later became annoyed when the hoax began to damage his reputation as a serious astronomer. A year later in 1836, Locke left The Sun and started working at New Era, the latest penny paper, papers that appealed to a wider audience with a cheaper price and a more narrative style of journalism. Shortly after joining the publication, he added, "Author of the Moon Hoax," to his byline. He would go on to write that the lunar narrative was intended to be a satire against the unchecked influence of religion upon science. Locke would leave journalism in 1842 for a job with the Customs Service. When he died in 1871, his obituary ran on the front page of The Sun, which said in part, quote, "Richard Adams Locke died on Staten Island on Thursday, in his 71st year. Mr. Locke was the author of the Moon Hoax, the most successful scientific joke ever published, which originally appeared in The Sun." The story was told with a minuteness of detail and dexterous use of technical phrases that not only imposed upon the ordinary reader but deceived and puzzled men of science to an astonishing degree. Unquote. Part 5. Was it plagiarism? 2 months before the Great Moon Hoax, the one and only Edgar Allan Poe had published his own moon hoax in late June 1835, in the Southern Literary Messenger entitled, Hans Fall, A Tale. It was later republished as, The Unparalleled Adventure of One Hans Fall. Edgar Allan Poe describes a voyage to the moon in a hot air balloon, in which Fall lives for 5 years on the moon with Lunarians and sends back a Lunarian to Earth. The story is regarded as one of the early examples of the modern science fiction genre. Poe planned to continue the hoax in further installments but was preempted by the Great Moon Hoax, which started in August. Poe later wrote that the satirical tone of the story made it easy for readers to see through the supposed hoax. The story was reprinted in the New York Transcript on September 2-5, 1835, under the headline, Lunar Discoveries, Extraordinary Aerial Voyage by Baron Hans Fall. Poe complained for nearly a decade that the Sun newspaper's Great Moon Hoax had plagiarized, by way of Richard Adams Locke, the basic idea from his story. Poe felt the Sun had made tremendous profits from his story without giving him a cent. Poe's story influenced, and is referenced in Jules Verne's From the Earth to the Moon, which can be seen as a retelling of the story. Verne acknowledged Poe as the creator of the scientific novel. And finally, in 1844, The Sun newspaper, the very same newspaper that published the Great Moon Hoax, published an article by Edgar Allan Poe. The article provided a detailed and highly plausible account of a lighter-than-air balloon trip by European balloonist Monck Mason, across the Atlantic Ocean taking 75 hours, along with a diagram and specifications of the craft. Probably inspired by the Great Moon Hoax, It was originally presented as a true story but was later revealed as a hoax, and retracted 2 days later. It is now known as the Balloon Hoax. We hope you enjoyed listening to our Listen to History audiobook. Please leave your thoughts in comments. And don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. Thank you.